Absolutely, yes.
How did this happen? I mean, it
So,
seems like this is really your baby
oh
from the very beginning.
yes. No, it's I read an article by coincidence in a French paper about animal therapy in prison, and I got very intrigued. I grew up as a kid being fascinated by prison, watching
I thought you
documentaries.
were going to say fascinated by animals.
No, I
You're
mean
fascinated by prison.
also
Okay.
I grew up with dogs, so I always loved animals.
Right.
But I was very intrigued by the sense of punishment. What does it mean to punish someone? What does it mean to lock someone in? What's happening then? What's the impact of prison on someone, and how he's supposed to live his life after? I mean, a lot of questions that kind of as a kid I was like half fascinated, half scared, but it's kind of like this, you know, attraction repulsion that I kind of like really pulled me into this subject. And I decided to contact the journalist of this article, and I went in this prison. It was in France. It was this woman entrusting small animals to inmates, like rabbits and birds and chinchillas even, and mouse. I was like, this is a comedy, you know, this is really,
Yes.
I want to see what's happening there.
Dr. Doolittle goes to jail.
Yeah, and so I met her, and I could witness her work, and it was very heartbreaking because those men was surviving through, you know, this empathy and this love that it was just discovering, and I thought it was beautiful. So I wrote and directed Rabbit, which is a short film that I did in 2013 in Rikers Island. It was still the window where we could shoot at Rikers. It was very, you know, several months. I got lucky enough to have the access there and shoot there.
So what were
And
you doing in was being in New
in New
York
York. So
coincidental
I was,
or?
no, I was at the time I was living there. So I did my first short film, Atlantic Avenue in Brooklyn. And there was my second one. So that's why I wanted to work with the same crew and, you know, be in my environment. So that's how I ended up doing it in New York and not in France.
Many, many years ago, I did a comedy show at Rikers. I was not the comedian, but went with comics to Rikers Island, and
Really?
they were the the murder group. They were the dangerous group, and one of the guys started making fun of them, and that was like his act. And it was we got about 10 minutes into that, and we're like, okay, come on, you're done, because we were afraid we were gonna have a riot anyway.
Yeah,
So yeah, shooting
yes.
going to Rikers is
But it's
a
an experience.
mind-blowing experience. Yeah.
It's an island, and when they say, look, maybe sometime, it doesn't happen often, but sometime, maybe, you know, it's gonna be a riot. So we shut
Maybe,
the
whatever,
prison, and you have to stay here until we finally find. And I was like, really? Yes, but it's, don't worry, it's fine, it happens in the past, but it doesn't happen often. So once again, don't worry. I was like, yeah, I just don't want to spend my night here or my weekend or whatever, you know. Anyway, it was snowing outside. It was kind of like all the elements of a horror film. We were in the abandoned building of Rikers, and it was dark outside, and it's like winds was blowing, and we weren't there. And it was just a wonderful experience for 3 days. We brought a lot of animals because it was like a last shot. We had a parrot, with bunny. We had a fox. We brought like many kind of species. It was like very absurd, you know, like this kind of mixing elements with that not supposed to, you know, to meet or coincide. And then I was still very moved by the subject. So I was reading a lot of articles, and I found this prison in Nevada with wild horses. So the rabbit became a horse. And I was like, that's the future farm. I want to explore. I want to spend more time in this environment and to dig even more into this complexity of a prison system, especially here in this country.
So
So,
before we go into the movie, what made you want to be a filmmaker in the first place?
So I grew up as a child. My parents are film producers,
Oh.
and I grew up being on set with them,
So it's natural.
acting as a kid. I was like, I started acting when I was 5 years old, and then 7, 8,
Did you
10.
like it, or were you just kind of going along with the ride?
It was a bit of both, because I was 5 years old, you know. I don't remember myself being like, oh, I choose that, but I know that I loved acting. I loved acting because also I was used to it. It was kind of my, you know, my environment. And my parents are cinephiles, they love cinema. And so they shared this experience with us, with my little brother and me. Mm-hmm. And for us it was a game, you know, going on set, understanding what's whoever was doing what, and like for me being costumes and like all the it was just fun. And I did this film in China with my mother. Mm-hmm. She was producer. I was an actress. I was 10 years old. It was all this summer. It was in 1993. So I turned 10 years old on the top of the Huanshan Mountains, were famous for all this kind of fog and being mm-hmm. very romantic and poetic, and China was just opening the doors to the world. So it was an experience not only being in very far away from my house, but also discovering a culture and not spending the 1 or 2 weeks that you would spend when you go on holidays with your family, just spending mm-hmm. 2 months in Hangzhou and the Huanshan. It's like all this adventure. I was like, but this is wonderful. I want to be an actor. I mean, who wouldn't? And then as a teenager, I grew up, and then I had this little voice in my, this awareness, you know, as I was not a kid anymore. And then it was not as natural as acting, you know, because right. as a kid, you're like, do that, do this. Sure, yeah, you know, it's like you go with the flow, it's a game. So you play. Mm-hmm. But then playing as an adult was like, I don't know if I can do that. I'm too aware of myself, self-aware, you know, I'm like too controlling. Is it my nature? Is it really what I want to do? So I did a Master of History at La Sorbonne, which was at some point being a journalist, but I was not. But then I was like, oh, I miss acting. This is what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And actually the study, and then going back to acting school, and then living in New York a little bit as an actor, going to an American acting school. Mm. And it was like, that's not for me. It's not my right shoes. It's just not my right shoes. You know, I'm fighting something that's not natural. So I directed a play. I was 25, and I loved it. And I was like, oh, finally, I found my right shoes. That's the good side.
So it fit right away. It felt right to you.
Immediately. And what I loved, and also what I felt comfortable with, is that all those years of watching film with my family, especially my parents, understanding actors because I was there and I could, you know, relate to that and to this process was actually my preparation of being a director. I never went to film school, never. I had no idea when I started what was a lens, or, I mean, roughly, you know, not that I was completely ignorant, but I didn't learn nothing about specificities of filmmaking, but what I knew, it was like directing actors, talking to actors, have empathy, know how vulnerable it is, create a safe space and a dialogue, and just being very instinctive, you know, sometimes being a little bit unconscious, it's good. Because if I had known all the obstacles, all the problems I would get, I would have been just much more scared, or maybe I would have just not doing it. I don't know. I was just bold about it. I was like, just let's do this, and this is what I see, this is what I feel, and then by, you know, watching films, that was kind of like my Bible, like watching, observing, and then it felt more organic. And I was also surrounded by friends at the beginning when I started directing. My first short film was just friends around me that knew more than me, you know, could guide me. It's like, okay, so this is a long lens. That is a short lens. I was like, thanks. And obviously, I mean, the second short film I knew more, and then more and more until my feature, or I felt more comfortable. You learn. So it's such a learning experience all your life. I feel that now. When I think about Mustang, I was like, there's still a lot of things that I didn't know. And I think it's pretty good not to know. I'm happy I didn't go to school. Maybe it would have been wonderful. Maybe that would have, you know. But I feel that I'm confident sometimes in just when you feel something and it's instinctive and you feel good about it, you get more freedom.
Well, they say for actors that, you know, it's always about finding the mistake.
Yes.
That the unexpected moment in the take that where it's interesting.
The happy accident, something you'd never predict. Yeah. So if you have too much rules, then you're much controlled. So not knowing sometimes is good just for freedom. Yeah.
Well, some people are, you know, big on rules, big on storyboarding every shot, and you know, and that's how they operate. But everybody has their own vision and their own idea.
Yes, I like improvising. I like that putting, you know, when you have everyone there, you have planned, you're prepared, everything. But then sometimes you have like this last minute idea that you, that's the one. Sorry, we're going to change everything. But that's the happy accident, because it happens at the moment, here and now, where you're doing it. And then it's just sometimes spectacularly, you know, right at the right place. And, right. And I love that. I love those moments. We had some of that during the film, during Mustang, with Matthias and with the horse and with the horse trainer and with the DP all together. Sometimes we were just like, okay, that's not right. Let's do this. And yeah, it's just about being prepared so that you can be free to improvise.
So is having Matthias intimidating? Is it as a, you know, doing your first feature length film? Is that a lot, or is that just what you should be doing?
No, I mean, yes, I was intimidated, because I loved his work. I knew him since several years, not really well, but we had the same French agent. We shared this beautiful story that I met his mother before him, randomly with my French agent. We had this conversation because his mother was doing some meditation work in prison in Belgium. She sadly passed several months after I met her. And then when I met with Matthias, we had that because he knew, because she told him, oh, I met this young French director. She did this short film about this prison program. And yes, she's writing this. It was a long time ago. So that kind of like I felt immediately something like very... He could be like a Belgian cousin. There was this proximity through like this gift of his mother before, kind of reconnecting us before going away, and that was beautiful. So we had this intimacy, immediate intimacy. He loved he connected with the character on very personal level, which I was very grateful, because he got really invested. We were driven by the same passion to tell the story. We went to prison together. To absorb, to meet inmates, because this is what I did for years. I wanted to be there to understand anger, to understand also the prison system. And on the other side, I followed this program step by step in this prison in Nevada. So he came with me. And all this process prior to do the film was actually building this trust and this friendship that was very, very necessary during the shoot, because it was an aggressive schedule, it was tense, and if we didn't have this relationship, it would have been much more difficult.
So is the prison system in Arizona a very different energy than Rikers Island or other prisons you've been to?
Oh yeah, Nevada is...
Nevada, sorry.
Yeah, the Nevada is...
Putting you in the wrong state.
It's not... I mean, it's in the West, but it's... It's beautiful because there's this program that we have 1,000 of white horses in this prison, which is weird. Very contrasted. What I was attracted to that, I was like this moral contrast. On one hand, it's wonderful, and the other one is terrifying. Why would you do that? Why would you put all those horses in prison? Why? Because it's a money process. It's like those farmers don't want white horses in their land, so they push them away because they want more land for the cows, because cows bring money and horses don't. Same thing. So they say, oh yeah, but the horses need to be, population control, and also they're starving in the wild, which is not true. Anyway, so you have that thing. And on the other hand, you give a horse to an inmate who suffered from lack of love, and imprisonment, and solitude, and antisocial, and then you take them back 3 months after. So there's kind of like all those different aspects of this program was for me like built all those contrast of moral contrast and narrative contrast that, in my European lens, was interesting to explore, with a little bit of irony that I always felt was kind of like distant from that, because I had a little bit of second degree about it. And also, when I arrived in Nevada, in this prison specifically, that's why I really wanted to shoot there. So you have the very rigid prison, traditional you know, like square and fences, and surrounded by this explosive nature, with wild horses like really roaming around the prison because it's really in their land. And that was very spectacular because all the change, the colors changing, the sun, the dust, and this desert, rocky mountains around there. I was like, that's specifically why I wanted to shoot there. Of course, the authenticity of having the program there, but the location, the contrast, the visual was absolutely stunning. And that's why I got really attached to it. And it was like a very, very long process to secure it. But
Had you spent any time in the kind of climate before, or in that kind of deserty?
Climate? Yeah.
Never.
We were in snow boots in the morning, and at noon we were on t-shirts. It was insane. Mm. Yeah.
Kind of like today here in LA.
Definitely.
It was like 40 degrees this morning, and now it's 80 something.
I know. Yeah, it's the same temperature. Actually.
No horses, though, sadly.
I adopted the horse of the farm.
Huh.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
Luke.
Is he traveling with you, or?
He's in Burbank.
Oh, he's in Burbank?
Yeah, he lives in Burbank at the Equestrian Center.
Wow.
Yes, my producer and I, we decided to keep the horse.
So do you ride him, or
do you? I rode him 2 days ago, yes.
Did he have to be broken, or was he, I guess he was broken
this
before?
This one was a trained one. Yeah. So we had three similar horses. We had the trained one, the one we kept.
Yeah.
One was semi-wild, was a Mustang, and another one was completely wild, was Mustang as well. And so the horse trainer knew how to work with each of them according to the scene. So we knew that, oh, that's Buck scene, oh, that's Luke scene, oh, that's Max scene. It's like, so it was really, it gave a lot of discipline to the shoot, because that was kind of like the key of the success of the shoot, just having the horse be on the horse's time.
Yeah. So did you, okay, so you wrote the screenplay, you co-wrote the screenplay?
Yeah.
As I recall?
Yeah, we're three writers on it.
So had Matthias been involved before the screenplay was done, or was that after the screenplay happened?
After it was done, yeah, in 2016.
So it struck me watching the movie that maybe there was more screenplay that you didn't use, that there were fewer words in the movie than maybe you had in your original screenplay. Or is that the case? Is that not the case?
Oh, yes. We got rid of so much. Yes, because it's... obviously, I knew that one of the lead actors was silent.
Mm-hmm.
So lot of scenes was going to be silent. So that's I knew that, and this is what I wanted. I was expecting that, like those invisible dialogues between man and horse. But you know, you're never confident enough that it's going to be exciting enough. So when you write too much because you think you're not confident enough in the cinema. And when you're on set, you're like, don't need. And Matthias was very helpful to that. He was like, Roman would never do that. He would never say that. That's too much. That feels forced. And so I was like, you're right. And once we're there, once we are, you know.
Sorry, we have somebody in the background doing sawing of some kind, but I'm sure we're fine.
But once we are in the process of doing it, it becomes much more clear. So for me, I was never really attached to any, you know, it's like it's not Shakespeare, so right. it's like you can lift words. I didn't really care about that, you know. As I thought it was really a film about emotions and sound and silence, and so it's words were not really important. Maybe like in the scenes with the daughter, because this really when he actually talks for kind of the first time what happened, but otherwise no. It was and also in the editing process we lifted a bunch of scenes
even more.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Well, Matthias is kind of one of the great silent actors of his generation, as turned out. I don't know that we expected that when we first saw him, but
yeah.
I mean, he was kind of silent in the first movie also, quite quiet, but he's a very physical presence. He's very Brando-esque in a way.
Completely, yes. Yeah. And he's very agile with his body. He's a very athletic. So his body speaks a lot. And his eyes, too. He has this mystery, but also like this very raw... expression of emotions. So he goes from 0 to 10 in a second, you know, with his emotion that go through and breaks the mystery. So he's very fascinating. Yes, he does nothing and a lot of happens. So that's rare. That's a very rare quality.
Well, it's funny because this for movie to movie, you don't always recognize him instantly because he has such a, he breaks it down, he builds it up. Sometimes mm-hmm. he very much looks like a movie star. Sometimes he's like, looks like a, you know, like a beast of some kind yeah. almost. It's yes. quite a remarkable skill set.
Yes, and he's willing to do that. He loves transformation. Like a lot of actors, but he's not someone that's gonna like be on the script for you know and take hours and there's a lot of actors do that too. Very yeah. like into the words, and also it was not the right work for being into you know like the literature of it. It was his approach is very emotional. He needs to absorb. He doesn't want to rehearse or damage because he thinks that he likes the freshness. Mm. He likes the first instinct. And yes, it's intuitive, instinctive. It's very animalistic in his acting approach.
So does he bring that guy to you when you are about to start the show or the movie, and you tweak it a little bit, or did you have long conversations about where you wanted him?
We talked a lot, and what we did also that I think was very important for both of us. We went to San Quentin because I met through this process of research this woman who is the health of mental department, who the head of health department, in a Northern California prison. Mm-hmm. Her name is Kathleen O'Meara, and she was very helpful to me to access prison, and she kind of like knew men that was going to be helpful to me for the story. And mm-hmm. she made that relationship happening, or I was in rooms sometimes for 8 hours with men who are lifers, who are sometimes never going to get out, who all there for very, very aggressive crime. And I was looking for the theme of the character. What's the theme of Roman? What's the trigger of his violence? And it's a domestic abuse. And what triggers that? Is it abandonment? Is it ego? Is it protection? Is it what's that? Mm-hmm. And to understand, so I really kind of like narrow down get the specifics by talking for hours with those men, which like was the best part, I have to say, the mm-hmm. most heartbreaking human part, and what I was really willing to do. And Matthias and I went together 1 week, and we spent time in San Quentin with a man who, for the first time, in front of us, was telling about his crime. So it was I had talked with a lot of men who was always used to talk about it. This one never. Hmm. And that, I think, was for Matthias. He had to sink in and to absorb. And it was a traumatic experience. It was so strong to have this man emotionally that was for the first time experiencing like wording of like the very violent crime, the murder he did. And we were there witnessing that. And we left this place, and we knew that at that moment specifically, we understood our character. Hmm. We knew who he was.
Have you seen The Work, the documentary The Work?
The Work?
Yeah, it's called The Work. We should get a copy of that for you.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I want to say Joliet, but it's not. It's the prison that Johnny Cash sang about, Folsom.
Yes.
And they have a program for inmates where they just have the inmates and some facilitators, and it's like a 3-day weekend, and they do it, I guess, twice a year, and they are no guards. And it's just the people who are in there, and the whole idea is for them to talk about their feelings, which they feel like they can't do any other time because it's not safe to have feelings on the yard.
Absolutely.
Because somebody will kill you.
Yeah.
So it's these 30 men, and then they bring in other men from the outside who have volunteered, and it's just kind of, it's a remarkable movie. It's
the
Work. You would
appreciate
it more than anybody.
Yeah, absolutely. I will definitely look it.
This, of course, will be qualified as a sexist question, but you're blonde haired, blue eyed, you're a girl, a woman. And you, are you even conscious of that when you go into a prison like that? And
yes, but I was a woman. I was Kathleen, the woman that helped me a lot, was also working there as a woman. So going there together, being a team together, and seeing her, I never felt, obviously, whether intimidated or scared. The first time, obviously, I was in a room with people who were willing to talk, so I knew that I was not trying to steal something from them, which would have made me feel like, you know, you're a journalist, and you're like, oh, do you want to And I was like, no, I'm not here just to, I'm not a voyeuristic. I didn't want them to feel that I was voyeurist.
Right.
And that's was, when they understood that I was a writer, director, doing my first feature, that I really wanted to be authentic and understand, so that that made also feel them better. Because they saw that they were like contributing to an art right. house film, so that was, they were for them, it was like a, it was rewarding in a way.
So it wasn't about being a woman, it was about being asking them for something. It was more of an issue
that,
for
that
you.
That was more the issue. I was like, I don't want them to feel that I'm just, you know, as someone who's, there's like, there's something sometimes very, there's a certain perversion mm-hmm. of going there and looking at people miserability, people issues, people mm-hmm. pain, you know, there's, and I didn't want them to feel that I was just sucking it and, you know, and mm-hmm. taking and without giving back. So that was my first issue. And then actually being a woman, yes, there's a softness about my maternal gaze was making them feel, I'm sure, softer and maybe more at ease than if I was a man. And maybe not. Mm. But for men, I guess, to be locked in, they have women working around them. It's not that mm-hmm. They were seeing a woman for the first time between, you know, after 20 years.
20 years, yeah.
No, there's a lot of guards, women, a lot of staff people, women. My friend Kathleen, women. It's a lot of women in prison, in a men prison. No, I think there was like the conversation went deep in their intimacy and their stories because I had no judgment, never. Because women are maternal, so there's this you know, this gaze, the softness that woman has that probably made them feel comfortable, made like the conversation feel good. I never felt threatened, never felt weird or anything. No.
So for you, is it more fun developing it and figuring it out and going through this whole process, or actually getting on the set and shooting the movie?
That process was so powerful. I grew up with that process. I think because you don't write or tell a story for no reason. Mm-hmm. After a while, I was like, oh, I might be talking about myself, actually. Roman is a prisoner, a man in America, and I'm not any of that. But there's a part of this, the feeling of imprisonment that in this psychological prison, the mental prison that I could feel as a young adult, and that stuck with me, and that feeling of being sometimes the loss of identity or trying to find who I was, maybe into my, you know, I specifically I had like, you know, some moments, and especially in my early 20s, where imprisonment. I felt trapped. I was in prison. I was in my femininity, in my identity. Yes, there was some issues that I think was unconsciously coming back, and I needed to explore that through Roman, and yes, that's definitely I felt that's why it was such a personal journey. Yeah.
So. It is interesting in the film, I think, in general, that we're conscious of the fact that they're in prison, but it doesn't feel like always like they're prisoners. Particularly Roman feels like he is a kind of like universe unto himself, and everything that's going on inside of his head and in his soul is actually kind of bigger than the prison. It's more significant than the bars that surround him. It's an interesting part of the movie.
Yeah, I think imprisonment is mental first. I think that's the painful one. That's the real prison. It's when you are trapped by your anger, your violence, when you have no control of yourself, and that's terrifying because you when you're in prison means that you made a mistake. Whatever it is, there's something that wrong that you did. You're punished by that. You don't really know how to go. What's the process? What's the to find a tool to survive or to be able to get out without coming back? And that pain is mental. It's really like that's the first imprisonment. Sometimes some men feel safe inside prison because they know that outside they're not able to be to survive. They're not able to be responsible, to be functional, and to be a citizen. They just don't know. So,
that's blamed for a lot of recidivism, like a lot of people that end up going back.
That's why,
because that's the only place they know.
Exactly.
It's safe.
Exactly, and it's like, yeah, they've been taken care of, and sometimes it feels safe to be taken care of, and that's why prison should be educational, should repair and educate, and not just punished stupidly, and then making people gaining out, and then they come back because. What they've got more than when they came? No, nothing. Yeah. Just being more abused and bruised and damaged and pain, you know, pain. So yes, at the end, Roman gets this slowly first, you know, freedom, internal freedom. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing he's gonna get.
So yeah. When you're actually shooting the picture, does it feel like a normal set out there, or are you kind of having fun with the actual work of capturing the images and the words, or is that kind of what you've all led to and now you're just kind of getting that part over with?
Yes, I mean, I loved researching. That was the part I was completely blown away by. And as I said earlier, I think I really grew up with that film. Right. So much about my humanity, my own sense of humanity and empathy. And the shooting was a very aggressive experience. We had 23 days to shoot the film with horses and stunts. We got flipped by the union that came the second day and shut down the film. So they said, say, it's 5 years of my life waiting for that film. Second day in the morning was like, it's done. People were leaving. So I was traumatized. I was like crying in the arms of the representative of the union, crying in her arms, saying, you're ruining my life. You know, I knew horror story about unions coming in, but this, I was like, no, not the second day. Not, don't do that. The first day was excellent. I was so excited. So it's true that all those obstacles made it very hard, but because, again, that project was driven by passion, and luckily, I'm so grateful that people came on board with that passion, like, oh, we're going to make it. No matter what, we're going to go through, you know, tempest and storm and unions and problems and money and lack of time. And so it was kind of a fight. It was a big fight. But I think the film had to be shot like that. I think the energy and also it was handheld, like, most of the time.
Right.
Two cameras, which was very helpful. If I was had to synchronize and do like choreographed shot, like forget about it. There was not the shoot to do that, but I wasn't expected it because I wanted to adapt to the unpredictable, you know, movement of the horse and the man and to some improvisation also. So we went with it and we fought and we shot the film in this 23 days and we did everything that we could. We actually never missed a scene, so we did. You know what we wanted to do.
So you just took the union rep and put her in a cell.
So and I wished I could. I wished. No, I was. I joined the union since. So I'm like, but at the time I was like, what's that? It's awful. It's terrifying. We were all so traumatized, and the crew. There's things like that damage the crew. You know, people then becomes like, you know, it's like this weird atmosphere that it creates when it's your first feature film and you finally get there and then it was, but
again. Well, films are all so much about a momentum.
Yeah.
You know, that so you once you're going, you don't want to stop.
Someone is like smashing your momentum and you're like, and you need to get all this energy, lifting this energy again because you need to make the film. And so Matthias and Ruben and a lot of crew member, like a lot of were wonderful and very supportive and yeah, fought hard, worked hard to finally get to to finish the on time to finish the film. I think this experience was also very gave so much solidarity, cemented especially like the, you know, like the camera crew and Matthias and I, we always like keep face and just we keep going.
So do you like post? Is post fun for you or?
I loved this shoot. So, but it was very tough. It was very tough, very. I mean, they're all tough. So, post, I love, editing, because my editor is one of my best friends. She's French. She's a genius. I think she's the brain in the team. And I love conversation with her about the film, about what we should keep, what she said. And we worked together since I started my short films, and she's very tough, because she really questions me deeply into what that means for you, what this, like, what's the logic of the narration. Mm-hmm. I was like, no, but I like that shot because you know that. No, and it doesn't. And it's true that she most of the time writes about. Mm-hmm. And it's nice because it's so sensitive when you have your material, you're so attached to everything. It's like, no, don't cut that. It feels like one arm is, you know, is going
to. You know how hard it was to get that shot? Like,
no. So it's like training, but with her, because I know her so well, because I know how brilliant she is and how careful she is and she will fight like an animal for the film and to protect also the vision. And so I have 100% trust in her.
So did you make many discoveries in this case in post, or did you kind of know what it was and then it was the detail work?
No, the discovery was some transition that I hadn't thought of, you know, in the script and also in shooting it and lifting scenes, or sometimes just one scene. You got two away, and then bam, and it's like, oh, but that's a, you know, and then the sense gets much better, and then it's emotionally, the emotions becomes more raw and more important. So, yeah.
Give me one second. Hi, you're a little early.
Oh yeah, I just wanted to introduce myself for Jonathan.
Hi, nice to meet you. We're in the middle of ours, but it's okay.
I'm so sorry.
Don't worry about it. Okay, sorry. But it always happens. No, it never happens. Anyway, the next interview is always pounding on that door. So you found transitions, and you found structure, restructuring?
Yeah, I found restructuring. Transitions. I found with structure. There was like a one major restructure that was really good. The ending also.
Hmm.
It was written like that, but it's just as a scene, the letter was a scene that would turn into a letter, because it was too much.
Mm.
There were things that felt too much. It's crazy how I was like, oh my God, this is so heavy-handed. So we wanted to make sure that, because that film, there's a Disney version of that film, we didn't want to go into that, you know, sentiment or being like cheesy or anything, and we all really tried to pull back and to be kind of like on the edge, just to be raw and to be just holding back on too much, on being like, you know, diving into something that would have been,
cute.
Yeah, we don't want
overly sweet.
We don't want cute or sweet. So yes, we it was this work of like just being on the edge, on the right balance of. That's the moment where you want to feel something and get an emotion, but then you cannot spend too much time on it. So it's like all this cut and transition was really important to kind of like give this nature, this roughness, and refine. And it's like between raw and refine. So we needed to really be very careful about that. So that was kind of like one of the most important field that we worked on.
And were you cutting up against a schedule? Were you heading to a festival, or were you just kind of cutting on your own pace and figuring it out later?
We actually at our own pace. I mean, at some point we couldn't spend for it.
Right.
So it's too much time there. But we were pretty. We did it for 20, almost 18 weeks. We did.
So did you know what you wanted to do with a finished product before you finished it, or did you?
Yes, I mean, the film was born in Sundance, so I was like, oh, that would be wonderful if the film can be, end this road in Sundance, because I was very, very helped by them, and also it was all my time in the West, where I was like between Utah, the labs, and prison in Nevada. So it felt that it belonged to there, and that was like the big reward that we finally got accepted there. Yeah.
So what was the screening, that first screening, like for you?
I mean, I was scared. My heart was beating fast. Mm-hmm. I was so scared and excited. I was like, I'm gonna share that with so many people that I don't know, because obviously before that you share it with your family, with your friends, with mm-hmm. like people, and that was like the big jump. and it was wonderful, and at the end people stand mm. on Matthias. Matthias came and it was like the standing ovation for him. And I was like, that's, and he was so, and he almost didn't come because he had like conflict.
Right.
And he was like, I'm so happy I came. I never had this welcome in my entire life. So that for us is a big memory.
Could you tell while the movie was playing that the audience was with it?
Sorry?
Could you feel the audience with the movie, connecting to the movie yeah. as you were watching?
Yes, and also sometimes they were laughing at moments that I would never, you know, like seeing was, I don't know how many people, maybe like 1,000 in this big screening.
You're in the
room.
Eccles or the
in
Racket
the Eccles?
Club? In the yeah. Eccles, yeah.
Yeah, so they were like, and sometimes they were reacting, I could see like some, and some laugh, and some like, you know, and I could hear some cries, which I was very happy. I was like, yes, crying. Yes, there is, and I stayed there. I was like there the entire time, and yeah, it was very unique.
And was the sale at Sundance, or did you?
No, we
had take
Focus,
a while.
Focus Features was on board already.
They were already on board?
Yeah, they were already on board.
So you didn't have to sweat that
no,
part of it?
No, so we didn't have this anxiety, which was great. It was
just, that's kind of nice.
Had to party after this premiere.
Uh-huh.
And yeah.
So did you, are you interested in the act of distribution and marketing, or are you kind of let them go do it?
No, I know. I think it's really important to be in sync and to know exactly how they want to talk about the film, or how to present it, or the trailer, or I always think trailers are cheesy and unnecessary, because I feel like, and especially here, sorry, but in France it's 1 minute, here it's three, and you're like, three, but I've seen the whole film. No, it's too much. So obviously things like that I cannot, and they were very nice and they said, yeah, you know, but we also have to sell the film and to attract people. So I understand that. If it was me, I would have just do
right.
one scene and that's it, you know, just to, anyway, I'm not a seller. It's not my job, so I respect people's job. And obviously, when I understood that it was a trailer that actually got attention, and was like, great. I want people to see the film, so I don't want to, you know, be stupid about it either. But they were good. They presented a great poster. Mm-hmm. And everything they did worked well, because the film met an audience, so they did the right thing, sure. Yeah.
And as the reviews came in and all of that, do you read all the reviews, or do you?
Yeah, I did.
Was that a fun experience? I mean, yes, in this case, it was a pretty good experience.
It was a good experience, yeah. Yes, yes. We had pretty positive reviews.
Do you learn from reviews, or do you just kind of enjoy basking in the glow?
Sometimes I enjoy because people see things that I was not aware, and it was like, oh yeah, that's right. But you know, sometimes anyone has its own projection on a film, so it's a very subjective experience. So, and it's sometimes it's there's something that was like, oh yeah, that's very smart about them. I haven't thought about that. You know, think that I have like my own discoveries. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it.
And are you now an American filmmaker or a French filmmaker?
I'm French filmmaker. I still have my European lens. I don't want to lose it, that lens. That's too important. That's who I am.
So will your next film be shot in Europe, or do you
the
know yet?
The next film will be shot in the East Coast, so I'm getting closer to Europe.
Okay, you're making slowly moving. You still have to get in a boat.
Exactly.
So and the next one will be about the Titanic.
And I do a film in the boat with a horse. No, that's, I live here for the moment, so I'm also excited to find those subjects, those very contrasted subjects. There's a lot here in this country, so
I'm will you exploring. Take in the meetings where the studios are talking to you about more commercial, maybe silly films that you wouldn't necessarily want to do, or
I don't want to do I mean,
but they're asking a little bit.
No, because I know that I will never do a big action hero film, because it's just not what I like. Mm-hmm. So I would not.
So it's not even like intriguing to you as a subject, as a kind of an exercise.
No, if I have to do it in my life once, big film, and just be in this, you know, in this, I would love to do Disney, because I love Disney. But otherwise, I don't connect with any Marvel or superhero because I just never read or watched, or I just don't. It's not my connection. I mean, it's not my thing. But it can change. Maybe when I have kids, I will have wanted, you know, do more for them. I don't know. Right now, it's I need to do my second feature films. That's art house film, and
will be in English and shot in the East Coast.
Yeah.
So are you anxious to go shoot in French, or does it really matter to you specifically?
No, I never shot in France. It's crazy. And in French, I never shot in my own language. I'm excited to do it. Maybe it's going to be more challenging for me, you know, because maybe I'm hiding here. But when I go back in my country, I'm going to be facing my roots and my identity and my, not that I denying my identity here, but... I'm going to feel more pressure, maybe. I don't know.
Well, aside from your family, do you feel part of the French film culture? Or do you were you more part of our indie scene in the United States?
French culture, French cinema, definitely. Yes, that's... I've been raised watching so many French movies from the 30s, which I really love. And I watched a lot of film noir with my father. We had this thing together. We watched Western and film noir with Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall. And I think that fed my imagination as a kid, because Mustang is Western and prison film. So it's like a projection from a young French child on the American world. Mm-hmm. And I love also American cinema. I think I'm interested about blending those worlds, like Sergio Leone or Wim Wenders with Paris, Texas, and Once Upon a Time in the West, Once Upon a Time in America, and all the... I think that there's nothing more exciting for me to juxtapose lenses and to see a world that it's not mine through my European lens, and kind of... I like cultural juxtaposition.
Hmm. So it could be anything.
So I'm a hybrid between France.
A hybrid, yes.
A hybrid between France and America.
And maybe you'll spend some time in Japan, and then it'll be a whole other thing.
Why not?
You could be a little of everything.
Why not?
So you're a director now. That's your writer-director. That's who you're going to be.
Yes.
Not back to acting.
Never.
Never ever?
No. Never ever. I'm terrible. No.
You feel like a terrible actor? You don't feel like a good actor?
I don't think I'm good. No. I don't know, because I just there's something about an actor that can do and that cannot do. It's like they can let it go and just abandon themselves.
There's not your thing.
I didn't know. I was so self-conscious.
But as a director, you can.
Yes. Weirdly, huh?
There you go.
It's weird, huh?
You found your place.
Yeah.
You're very fortunate at a young age to find what you want to, you know, what your thing is.
Yes.
And what your thing is not.
Exactly.
It's a challenge. Yeah. Thank you so much for your
time. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the conversation.
A pleasure.